Thank you, Donna. Well, thank you for welcoming me back. It's always great to speak in front of you. I think the first time was 5 years ago on a day very similar today. It was a massive snowstorm. It happened to be January 30th. So, and then the time after that you invited me, you also put me up against an opera singer. So I'm up to the challenge, I hope. Today I will talk to you a little bit about the future and about seeking what the future for Madison and what that's going to look like. But before I do that, I'm going to take you just back a little bit. The first time that I spoke to you, I asked you to imagine, believe, and then do. So go back 5 years ago on that blistery January day. I asked you to imagine Greater Madison as a global innovation hub. When I came back a few years later, I told you to believe in the four trends that were defining Madison. Today, I'm going to ask you to not just better understand the work we're doing, but to contribute on your own to do the acceleration of Madison as we head into this great future that we have in front of us. But before I get to the future, I want to start with the past. So 117 years ago, this past Monday, on April 16th, 1901, there was a momentous moment that probably none of you other than David Mollenhoff probably know about. And so I'm going to ask you a question, and everyone but David and probably Stu Levitin are allowed to raise their hand, but those two are exempted from this question. How many of you know the story of the 40,000 Club? Did you learn it from me? Okay. All right, well, good. It's a blank canvas to paint on. On this 117 years ago, on last Monday, a group of leaders, who were called the Young Upstarts of Madison, got together and formed a new organization called the 40,000 Club. The 40,000 Club was designed to address the future challenges of Madison as they saw it. At the time, Madison was 19,500 or so people in population. Their goal was, by the change of the decades, so in less than 10 years, they were going to double the population of Madison. And they had six ways that they were going to do that. The fifth of those was to, well, it's kind of blurry. Let me use some chamber magic to clear that up for you. All right, to establish a correspondence and advertising bureau to attract attention to the advantages of Madison. And they started with not just building our collective belief. They went around and they spoke to the civic organizations of the day, and I suspect that you can probably trace some of your roots, much like the chamber can trace many of its roots, back to this group of young upstarts. But they did a book later on, the Chamber, which was then called the Board of Commerce, which you've reproduced a number of times. Many of you hopefully have seen the four-leg book. We recently were able to get an original copy of it, and original copies do exist. They're rare, but there are a few original copies out there. But the copy that we got, which was from a woman who bought a storage locker in Las Vegas, Nevada, who called one day and said, "I think I have something that you might want." And our response was, "It's been reproduced thousands of times or thousands of copies." She said, "No, I think this might be the original." And we said, "Does it have an M and a W on the front, or does it have an embossed logo?" And she said, "It has an embossed logo." And we said, "Yeah, we'll take that." And to her credit, she didn't sell it to us. She gave it to us for free. In there, what we discovered that no one had ever seen before was this postcard, which was designed from the sender to take out and then send around the country with the book. So the book was essentially our invitation to come visit. And you can see in the top, it was only able to be used till 1919. After that, it was going to be void. But I love this last line of saying that we have the opportunity of showing you in person some of the scenes that this booklet but poorly describes. And what they knew then is that experiences matter. That in order to showcase this beautiful place, you have to experience it. And what they were challenged by that then 117 years ago was both reality and the perception. The reality was Madison was a growing technology hub, different technologies. It was sugar beets and buggies and energy, but they were at the same, in engine parts, and Madison Kipp was the first successful recruit of the 40,000 Club. They were able to lure Madison Kipp Company here. The reality of it was they needed talent, they needed workforce. The perception was that Madison was a place of education and the functions of government. It was not a place of business. So as they went to address the reality, we find ourselves in that same position today, which is trying to address the reality of what's going on. So when I told you 5 years ago that you should embrace and imagine Madison as an innovation hub, as a global innovation hub, it's happening. And I'm going to show you some economic data that backs that up. Even if you haven't felt it yet, the data is leading the indicators, and you will soon feel it. Madison, from 2015 to 2016, led the nation in momentum in advanced industries, but specifically in the technology space. USA Today called it the city with the most momentum. So we outpaced large and small markets when it comes to the percentage increase in those types of jobs, a 30% increase in one single year, a 52% increase over the span of 3 years. The net employment outlook for Madison, based on a recent Manpower Group survey, Madison is number 3 in the country for confidence that employers have that the economy will continue to grow and that they will continue to hire. Other cities that we would consider our peers, and whether, I don't know who you consider the peers of Madison, we consider cities like Austin and Raleigh and San Francisco and Silicon Valley and Boston to be our peers. And you can see those cities were significantly below us, and look at the bottom of the pack. San Jose and San Francisco, the meccas of innovation, the confidence that those employers have that they will continue on the trajectory is nowhere near what Madison's optimism is. If you look at national average for tech workers, Madison's significantly above the national average, but look again who our counterparts are. Look who again who we align with. That's good company to keep when you see Austin and Seattle and San Diego and Boulder and Denver and Salt Lake City and Portland, Oregon, just right above us. And other than the outliers of Silicon Valley and San Francisco, there's a big grouping right there. Madison also is unique in the sense that it is growing not just in size, but in market share. So we are outpacing our percentage increase nationally. So we are growing in the net gain of market share when it comes to these communities. Again, look at those cities above us who are also growing their market share. The number I want you to remember today when it talks about economic data is 2.2. So we spend a lot of time thinking about where does wealth come from, right? This was the same challenge that the 40,000 Club thought about. We couldn't be the place where people just brought their goods and redistributed it. We couldn't just be the place that educated the world's talent or the state's talent and then shipped it off. And we certainly couldn't be the place that was just the function of government, which imports wealth, doesn't create wealth. So as the business organization, we think a lot about where does wealth create? How do you create wealth? Where does it come from? How do you import those dollars? And the 2.2 matters because for every one of those advanced industry jobs that we talk about, there are 2.2 other jobs created because of that one single job. So I'll illustrate that for you using technology as an example, but this holds up across all advanced industries. So total tech talent in 2016 employment was just over 23,000 in Madison. Those same companies employed 48,000 people who were in non-tech roles. So you can start to see how those jobs create additional jobs, which create wealth, which create disposable income, which creates community wealth, and that's how you have prosperity. Madison also tops the charts, as many of you know, in educational attainment. This is something that we've bragged about for many decades, but it holds up continuing to be true. Only Seattle and Washington have higher educational attainment rates. We also lead the country when it comes to the density in young people and young talent being millennials in the young professional range. So we're not talking about college students, we're talking about post-college. We are number one in the country with 26.5% of our population is in that target demographic. So it wouldn't surprise any of us then when you overlay those on top of each other that the percentage of college graduates that are millennials, so 25 to 34 in Madison, we are second only to Boston and then only by a few tenths of a percent. So these are great indicators of what's happening when it comes to our city. That notoriety, so much so, has created international visibility, it's created national visibility. It's also changing the perception of how in-state visibility. When is the last time you ever heard someone outstate brag about Madison other than a Badger victory? It doesn't happen very often. And we saw this headline recently from the Journal Sentinel in Milwaukee that said, Milwaukee's long shot bid to land Amazon headquarters plays on Chicago, which makes sense, international airport, and Madison's ties. And when you really start to dig into it, you start to see how much both Mayor Barrett, the mayor of Milwaukee, and the county executive of Waukesha had to say positive about the talent that resides here. What they were trying to convince Seattle or Amazon of is that this region, which includes Madison now in their mind, is a place of talent. And you can see at the end, it's all about the talent, right? That's what this is about when they started to link us. So this is a great opportunity for us to continue to tell and expand Madison's economic story throughout the Midwest and throughout the state and throughout the country and the world. And the reality of that is because of that, this is what you start to see, and more people in Madison look like this than ever before. Still need a few more in here, I think. We got to track some, but And Niche and Forbes and Career Builder and Realtor, great national publications, are leading the way and highlighting Madison in the top 10 of just about every ranking you can think of. Best place to start a career, best place to be a young mother, best place to be a young entrepreneur. If you don't see Madison on the list, I question the data behind it. And also, Forbes 30 under 30, for the last 3 years, has had a Madisonian on that list. So for 3 years in a row now, we've had three different teams or people, and all of them in the technology space. Health tech, consumer tech, platform technologies. And so you're seeing the opportunities to not just tell our story, but share those experiences, what it's like to be here. So it wouldn't surprise you either that when you look at digital scores or skill sets, so what does it take to have a job here? That as of this last year, 3/4 of all jobs in Madison now require medium to high digital skills. In fact, we're number 10 in the country when it comes to the average amount of technology needed for jobs to be here. So we have young talent, we're creating the right types of jobs that create wealth, and we are thankfully being able to merge those two because the skill sets are matching up. We're also graduating people in the right areas because people are paying attention to this is where the jobs of the future are. Over the last couple of years, total degrees given in this region, tech increased by 32%, computer engineering by 51%, math and statistics by 56%, and other tech and engineering increased 8%. But even if we were to keep every single graduate of every single university or college, we still wouldn't have enough people. The good news is that at K-12 level, Madison's doing an amazing job of creating innovators. In fact, we're second only to Silicon Valley in the creation of innovators that come from our K-12 system. A tribute to our schools, our teachers, and all of us who have made those major investments in keeping our schools vibrant and good. The challenge that we saw this stat last year. We brag about it, we still brag about it, that Madison produces it more innovators per capita than any other city other than San Jose. But when a new report came out a few months ago called The Lost Einsteins, and what we discovered is the reason for that increase, the reason for why Madison, and in fact every other city that's high above the median there, is because it's driven by young, white, wealthy men. That's essentially in Madison, if you want to be an innovator, it pays or it's required that you be white, male, and from a wealthy family. That's not going to hold up. So all the great stats that I told you about the trajectory, if there was an Achilles heel to this great story, this is it. And the reality of that is that if we could change that, if we could get more women and children of color, and if we could get more resources put into children who come from poverty, we could quadruple the innovation in Madison. Our economy, the innovation economy, would quadruple just by opening up those gates and allowing more access, more equity, and more inclusion in those areas. And to show you the problem, to illustrate that, in order for us to reach parity between men and women innovators in Madison, it would take 118 years to find a 50-50 balance. We don't have 118 years. We haven't had 118 years. We don't have another 118 years to figure this out. The other thing they battled was the perception of Madison. Let me introduce you to Leanne Heiss. In 2015, Leanne was one of the top recruits of Epic Systems. She was a top graduate at the University of Maryland in biology and neurology, and Epic really wanted her. And as Epic does, they have 100,000 of people apply for jobs each year. They take a couple thousand. But in the interviews, they said to Leanne, like they would say to any other top recruit, we're going to give you an amazing job. You're going to change healthcare. You're going to work at a great company with great vision and great leadership. We're going to pay you well. You're going to work on an amazing campus. And we're going to give you a portable skill set that when you're done at Epic, you can take it anywhere in the world and make a lot of money. Sounds good to just about any college graduate. But Leanne's question was, where is it at? And they said Madison, Wisconsin. Not wanting to embarrass herself, she didn't ask where is Madison, Wisconsin, but she didn't know where Madison, Wisconsin was. So she went back to her apartment, and she typed in Madison, Wisconsin. And these are the images that she got, thankfully. So she tells the story. She saw the images of Madison and said, I can see myself there. And she made the leap, and she moved here. But we left everything to the algorithm of Google. Our whole fate of recruiting this talent was left to Google's algorithm. What if she'd gotten that picture? On a day like today, it would not have been so out there. In fact, we think this is probably the perception that many people have. Cold college town, right? That's the perception that much of America has. In fact, when we tested this, 68% in 2004, 68% of the US said they had no impression of Madison, blank slate. Which is not a bad thing, because it means that you can build on that. Blank canvas means you can put great artwork on there. Imagine if we were Flint, Michigan, or a place where you had to change perceptions before you could even start to paint. We tested it again last year, and somehow it went up, and now 70% of America have no perception. So despite all the work that we've been doing since 1901, it keeps going the wrong direction. So why is that a problem? Well, you guys have seen these headlines. These are headlines collected over the last 10 years or so. The brain drain of Wisconsin, our in-migration is among the lowest in the nation. State firms need help. In fact, just last year, the State Journal ran a two-week expose on workers wanted. I'm sure you saw the headlines about the worker crisis, the dilemmas for schools, the dilemmas for cities, the dilemmas for businesses, and can they grow and expand here? We asked our leaders who recruit to Madison, so those companies that are recruiting not just wealth but talent, how do you sell Madison? What do people know about Madison? How do you recruit? What do you say? Are there differences based on gender or race or ethnicity? And then what do you need from us? And what they told us was they had an immediate need, that this is the thing that keeps them up at night. So everything looks great, right? Our businesses are growing, our economies are growing, growing in the right sectors. But what business leaders are saying privately is, this isn't sustainable. I can't find the talent that I need. And if something doesn't change, I'm not going to be able to grow and expand here. And they also told us they needed a place that sells the Madison experience. There's that word again, experience. One of the great lines that we learned was someone said, if we get them here for a visit, they're sold on the community. Right? There's that experience again, if they see it. You can't fly every person here. You can't bring everyone to Madison for them to experience. Thus, the postcard from 117 years ago was saying, please come here. I don't know how effective that was. I assume it wasn't as effective as they had hoped. But it's even less effective today to get somebody to come here to just see the city before. So the experiences matter. So what we did to start challenging that was we sat in our boardroom, and because we're also smart at the chamber, we decided we're going to create the headlines that sell the Madison experience. And we sat down and we had whiteboard after whiteboard that created these amazing headlines about this the place for information technology jobs. We're the place where food is the freshest because we're farm to table. We talked about the college sports that go on here. We talked about the biotech sector. We even went right at winter and said, winter sports are so hot right now. We talked about our ethos of how we think globally. And we even went after and said, we actually have a fashion industry here. And we framed it all around make a career, make a life, and make a difference. So it's not enough to have a job here. You will make a career here. It's not enough just to live here. You need to make a life here. And Madison is a place where you can make a difference. We were very proud of it. We rolled it out. We put it up, and nobody came. I mean, literally, no companies used it. No visitors went to it. It was an absolute bust. We stopped and asked ourselves, why is that? Why did nobody find connection to that? We thought these were great headlines. These are all true stories in our mind. None of this was illegitimate. And the reason was that we never stopped to ask, what's the authentic and motivating case? How do we meet talent where talent is, as opposed to just saying, Madison's great, we all know it, we all love it, let us tell you about it. We never stopped to think, what do they want? So we went to London, and we hired a company called Brain Juicer, which is one of the world's leaders in thinking differently about how you test brand. And so think of the focus group of seven people behind a two-way mirror where they're talking about a product or a brand or a slogan, and they tell you what they think, and then you take your notes, and then you launch from there. Their theory on that is those are completely ineffective, in fact, give you wrong or bad information, because people are horrible predictors of what they think. They believe that we are great predictors, or at least we think we're great predictors, of what other people think. So we are like, we'd love to tell you what other people would think. We challenge to tell us what we think. And the reason why I think they're right is that somebody told Pontiac to build the Aztec, and then nobody bought it, right? So those eight people lied to Pontiac. So we set out, we did a national perception study of 500 people. We oversampled two groups. We oversampled people of color, and we oversampled millennials, because millennials are the future. And what we wanted to test with people of color was, would this hold up across all sectors of the economy? If we made a statement that we felt was authentic, would it be authentic across the board? And if not, what would we have to do to change that? We tested 14 different concepts about Madison. We used archetypal psychology as the basis for them. So all state of the science, all based on some of the best research in the world. And the way they work is they ask people, what are the probabilities that someone would buy shares in this concept, in this idea? And what is the net preference that you have? What's the most likely to succeed and the least likely to succeed? And then they let you highlight every single word and you tell how you react to words. What words resonate with you, what words don't resonate with you. In fact, the word that tested the worst was Big Ten athletics. Well, of course, we were just incredulous about this and called up to London and said, "What? How did you get information that comes back and says everybody who took our survey hates Big Ten athletics?" And they said, "What's Big Ten athletics?" And so I'm trying to explain to them how like college sports works. They said, "Well, hold on a second. Is this like Manchester United versus Manchester City?" And you're like, kind of. And they said, right. So we surveyed people from all around the country who probably don't like your college. Or, and we then it dawned on us, there's a bunch of SEC people, ACC people. The good news in that is that we realized that we had the right demographic, that we were asking the question beyond the Wisconsin borders and beyond Madison's borders. So this is the continuum that they use. At the bottom at the red means do not invest your money. You will go broke if you put your money into this. As you go up the scale and get to green, if you get into the green, and very few brands get into the green, that is, go put all your money in it right now, run to the market. So when we came back, the one stars, the high loss risks, were just about everything that we put in that Make Madison site. Right? Agents of change, marching to a different beat, lightening up, above and beyond, the competitive spirit, things that we were saying about ourselves, nobody else in the country believes. When you look in that middle row, these so low returns are things that you can win, you can get there, but you're going to have to invest a lot of money. And they told us that things like Blazing Trail, the thirst for knowledge, the creative environment, those were going to be great places for us to put money in the future. The solid investments was harmony with the land. We think that's the Wisconsin brand creeping in because we kept the word Wisconsin. It said Madison, Wisconsin. A lot of debate whether we should take Wisconsin in and out, and we left it in. And the market beater, down to earth, was number one. So they thought this, Pleasantville. Which shouldn't surprise any of you because 70 years ago, this September in 1948, Life magazine put the front cover with The Good Life. And we've been selling this for 7 decades. So we shouldn't surprise anybody that people think this is Pleasantville. The challenge is they think that Des Moines is Pleasantville and Ann Arbor is Pleasantville, and it doesn't give you a differentiator. What did surprise us, though, is this idea of experiences over possessions. Right below it at 90% in the green. There's that word experiences again. And what that brand archetype is this idea of a seeker. So someone who yearns for something more, somebody who is a bit unsatisfied, somebody who wants to find new solutions and new ideas, people who are called trailblazers or explorers or individualists or questers or idealists or pioneers, things that I think you could overlay into the Madison ethos and say, yes, those are the type of people who we are. People who climb every mountain and feel every moment of that climb. And all you have to do is go to campus and look at this sign and you will see the purest definition of seeking, which is the continual and fearlessly sifting and winnowing. There is no other place in America that owns a seeker brand, and it was right under our nose and we never realized it. So we set out to say Madison is the ground level for the next big thing. Not Madison is the next big thing, but that the next big thing will happen here. And we took all the data and all the research and we created this video.
Oh, we up, up, up for the glow show. Yeah, we down here on the ground. Yeah, we up, 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 up above love. Yeah, we up, up, up in the clouds. Yeah, we up. Yeah, we up. Yeah, we up. Yeah, we up.
So everything in there, every word is tested against the seeker archetype, every image is tested against the archetype. The reason why there's a giraffe in there is because only big cities, only growing cities have zoos. Everything in there is designed to show scale and growth and energy. And the good news is that people like it. And that, and since we've put it up, 12,000 people have sought it out, not because it was on Google or because it was on YouTube, because it's actually embedded in an analytic platform, because companies are embedding it into their search and recruitment efforts. So around the country, you expect the upper Midwest to have density, but look at Austin, Texas, and Silicon Valley, and Seattle, and look at the Northeast and the DC area, and Boulder and Denver, and even places like Florida and Southern Texas. So weather is not necessarily the challenge. And when you zoom out globally, it has had a global impact. And so people, the message of Madison is starting to get out. Even Islamabad, Pakistan. One of our companies was recruiting for an HR lawyer, for a healthcare lawyer. They put it on their website. We were able to track back to them based on the analytics platform and say, a lawyer at that hospital in Islamabad, Pakistan looked at your posting. And so we have the great analytical data behind it as well. So what's the next step? Well, I told you about the 40,000 Club. Their big idea was we're going to fly kites over the isthmus, take pictures, and then put them together into panoramics. You can go to the Historic Society and see them. You can see them in Mr. Mollenhoff's book. They are beautiful. But instead of flying kites, we're going to fly drones. And we're going to use, instead of postcards, we're going to use augmented reality and virtual reality by using Google Cardboard. We rolled that out this fall to an annual dinner. If you weren't able to make it, you can see that we put up 180-degree screens. I'll just give you a bit of a test of what this virtual reality looks like. So you're seeing the Madison Capitol from a drone. You see sailboats out in the distance. Those sailboats are not real. We created those. You'll see a crane out there over by Edgewater. Those are not real. That's not a real crane. We created that. And we're able to overlay virtual reality inside of a video, which has never been done, and we did it all locally. All of the talent behind that, all of the technology behind that is created right here in Greater Madison. If you're young at heart, or if you have a grandchild, or you have a child, you probably know the Pokemon Go game. It was a phenomenon 2 years ago. People were falling off cliffs playing the game. But behind that technology was this idea of augmented reality. So we showed you virtual. Augmented, you can see the woman walking, and then you see in the camera or in the phone, you can see it augments her reality by putting a Pokemon figure in front of that. Well, we're doing the same thing. When you overlay my phone on our logo, you can see that the logo comes to life. You see the M for Madison, the W for Wisconsin, and then the arrow takes you, forwards you on to that 360-degree video that I just showed you so that the world's talent can use the world's newest technology in order to accomplish that. And the reason for that is because we want to meet talent where it is. And if you think that this is all futuristic, it's not. It's 17 to 27 months away. This is the computer of the future. This is what you will look at. Instead of looking at a monitor, you will see everything through lenses where you'll be able to see augmented reality and virtual reality and your actual reality, and it's going to be called mixed reality. This is not scientific, or this is not science fiction. This is the future, and it's almost here. And the reason why we're doing that is because the next time that Leanne Heiss, or the future Leanne Heiss, looks at a computer screen or is asked by a recruiter to come to Madison, she will have already got our postcard and she will have already seen our invite. So with that, I thank you for the time and the attention, and hopefully I have enough time to answer some questions.
Hi, Zach. First, an answer to one of your earlier questions. My understanding is that it's labor that creates wealth, but we'll get back to that.
soon it's going to be machines, but...
Given the importance of the university to everything about Madison, from its economy to its intellectual intensity to culture and society, how of concern is it to you that the recent years have not been good, as good to the university as earlier years have been? And are you concerned that the public relations perception of the university and the reality of the university is diminished as you're trying to sell the city?
Absolutely. I think it's both on trying to sell the city. It's also the ability for us to recruit the world's best and brightest here and hopefully retain them. So it's in our legislative agenda to actively lobby both at the federal and state level. So we actively lobby the legislature and the governor's office on funding for the university system. We also lobby at the federal level for increased funding for SBIR and STTR funding, so basic research funding. But it is a big risk. And the reason for that is that everything I just told you, I would argue, is because we are in the shadow of one of the world's great universities. I don't think that those things are disconnected. I think that is the reason for why that has occurred, or one of the major reasons why that has occurred. And someone once said to me, and if anybody went to Mizzou, I apologize, it's not an insult, but someone once said to me that to be a great regional university is hard. To be a world-class university is almost impossible. But to slide from a world-class to a regional university is very easy, and we could very quickly become Mizzou, which is a great university, but it is not a world-class university like the University of Wisconsin-Madison.
Hi, Zach.
Two of my favorite people at the same time.
Great job, as always. I've asked you this before, I think when you were last before us, so I'm hoping you can update us. Fantastic data. When we're in this climate where we continue to see our state leaders, legislators, governor's office continue to attack this area, attack our judges, even appointed by the current governor, actually go so far as to try and take sifting and winnowing out of state statutory language. How are we doing in working with our state leaders to have them understand this story and be our champions and advocates and drivers of the state economy rather than a subject of their scorn and ridicule? Okay. Thank you.
Absolutely. So our language is, there's a lot of up in the air what's going to happen in the next election. Is there going to be a blue wave? Is it a blue blip? Nobody really knows. What our message has been universally is the thing that is unacceptable to us as the business community in Madison is the idea that you would attack a local economy, that you would attack a region. Make the race about people, make the race about ideas, don't make it about a place. And so we push back very hard. Just so you know, we have set up legislative lobby days. Madison never had its own lobby day. We don't know why that was, but we now, every 2 years, invite all state leadership into a legislative day where we talk about what's going on in the economy. And last year, and now repeated this year, we launched a D.C. event. So we have an evening in D.C. where we invite the entire congressional delegation. And what I can tell you to answer that is, I think this is a positive sign, is that more Republicans than Democrats come to those events now and are learning things about the story that maybe they didn't hear before. And one final thing, we're working on a study right now that hopefully will roll out in the fall that shows the connectivity between industries here and the effect. So the idea that apples fall far from trees, so that Madison's tree spreads out across the state, and at the root of that tree is the university.
Thanks, Zach. I came through the airport yesterday, and there's a great big sign from a Texas company that says we're looking for a hospital technical types, and it's 62 degrees here. It's a very large sign. So my question is, I realize weather and all that didn't come up in this at all, but how does it play as a factor for millennials?
Sure. But they should have said it's 62 today. It's going to be 119 in July. But and you'll have no water. So what we're learning is that people are choosing place because of the ethos of a place, or the morality of a place, or the mores of a place. And people want four seasons. So I think last time I told you the story of me going through customs in Heathrow and the guy saying, "I don't know Wisconsin, tell me about it." And I said, "It's cold and we have lots of cheese." And I walked out thinking, I'm paid to tell the story. And I just told that guy the story that I say no one else should tell that story. And so we all have to get better at telling the story and sharing the experiences and embracing the four seasons. And one of the lines that we use and I think really works is, it may get cold at times, but Madison is a city that never freezes. And with that, I'll leave you with that. And you guys can go outside and be cold.
Thank you so much, Zach. I think we have two seasons. We don't have four. But anyway, wonderful presentation. We are adjourned.